welcome back, everyone. We are ready for part two of the tribute bill to Wild Willie Borsch. I appreciate all the really nice comments and remarks on the Winged Express, which was part one. I didn't do any updates on it. It was going so well that I just wanted to go ahead and get, I was kind of in a sink, and I wanted to go ahead and get it. There wasn't a lot to it, really, the kit. It was engine. That was pretty much it. The chassis wasn't much to the chassis, and the body just, you know, was fit in the palm of your hand. So really wasn't worth showing anything as far as painting it. It was just, quick paint job, clear coat, rubbed it out, put the decals on, and, you know, the body just, you know, it sat right down on top of the chassis without any issues. So I want to go ahead and get it finished while I was kind of rolling along there. Now we are ready for the Dodge Charger funny car that he drove after the Winged Express. And I'm not sure exactly when he started driving the funny car. I know that and just give you kind of a little backstory on him. And kind of what wanted me to do this tribute bill was just, he was a very colorful character. He was sort of eccentric, if you will. He was a tile layer by trade. Now, you have to remember, a lot of these guys back then, they had other jobs. They had primary jobs that was the majority of their income, and then they did this either as a hobby or, you know, whatever, driving for somebody. Willie happened to be partners with Al Marcellus, but he was a tile layer by trade. He was one of the remarks I read about him was that he's known for a couple of things. One of the things he's known for, if you know anything about Willie Borsch, is that his claim to fame was driving the Winged Express with one hand. And if you look at some of the pictures, images of him in the car, he has one hand on the side of the car, on the body of the car, hanging on, holding on. And the story is that he didn't even know he was doing that. And Al Marcellus actually asked him once, he said, "Really, why are you holding on to the car with one hand?" And he said, "I'm not holding on to the car." He said, "Yes, you are." And so they had to get one of the photographers that worked for, you know, one of the magazines or whatever, had been taking photos, showed him a picture of him in the car, and he was holding on. He didn't even realize it. But he drove pretty much all the time the Winged Express with one hand. And I've never driven, you know, an A-altered car, but I'm sure it was a handful to drive. He said one time that the car never did the same thing twice. And he said it was always, you know, you never knew what it was going to do and all that. So he was very strong, needless to say. They said buckets of 80-pound buckets of mud for the tile. And so he was able to do that. The other thing about him that I read that I thought was kind of interesting is that he was narcoleptic. And I don't know if they even knew what narcolepsy was way back then, but I'm sure they did. But Al Marcellus said once that he would be walking in the pits and Willie would be working on the car, sitting on his little mechanic scooter there or whatever. And he would be sitting there working on the car and he would just fall asleep, you know, putting bolts in or whatever. And he would, when they would go to make their time trial or to, you know, to actually race, they would be sitting in the line. You know, if you've ever been to a drag race, you know, both lanes, there's a line of cars with the push cars behind them or whatever. From back in that day, it was push car. Now it's, you know, bodies pushing the car because they've got, you know, 15 or 20 guys on the crew. But back in those days, they couldn't afford that. I mean, most teams couldn't. Ones that weren't, you know, corporate sponsored. So they would be lined up, you know, moving forward to get into their, make their time trial or make their run or race or whatever. And Willie would fall asleep sitting in the car. And they, when it come time for them to move forward, they would have to bump the car with the push vehicle and wake him up. And Al Marcellus said it was the damnedest thing he ever saw. You know, like if they were the next car to go up, he would be asleep and they would bump the car and he'd wake up and go down the track 200 miles an hour. So I thought that was really an interesting fact about Willie. And so anyway, after he drove the Wind Express, he was on the Revell Drive team. There was many, but several drivers who Revell sponsored. And I won't name all of them, I'm sure I can't with it off the top of my head, but there were many. Of course, Tom McEwen and Don Perdomo, the most famous. And then there was Ed McCullough, Alistair Green with Black Magic, several. But he entered into an agreement with Revell, and that didn't take long for that to go south. He did not want to, even though this was a Dodge Charger, he refused to run a Hemi. This car is powered by a big block Chevy, and there's several pictures of the car sitting in the pits with the body up, and you can see that Chevy engine red. I thought it was a Hemi. I got to look at the heads. I thought, no, that's not a Hemi. And then I read that he never did want to run a Hemi. He wanted to run a big block Chevy, and that was also one of the things that him and Al Marcellus did not see eye to eye on. And I guess the final nail in the coffin for that relationship was he was to make a public appearance, you know, for the car, for Revell or whatever, and they wanted him to wear a t-shirt. I don't know what he had on it. It had, you know, the Revell stuff on it or whatever, and he refused to wear it. And a lot of times he would just walk around the pits without any shirt on. And he refused to wear a shirt, and that was that. So that's pretty much it. Just a couple of things about Willie I thought was kind of interesting. He was his own guy. He did things the way he wanted to. And, he was, by no means was he a slouch as a driver. I think he's rated as the number 50. He's top in the top 50 drivers of all time. He is known for his attitude. He is known for telling it like it is. And, in the corporate world, when you take on these corporate deals, that doesn't always, as they say, gee-haw together too well. So, and one other thing, too, as I said, you know, he was always had his hand on the body or pretty much all the time on the Wind Express. If you look at this picture on the, you will see the hand on the body there hanging on. Well, since that was such a big deal with the Wind Express, now that's not Willie's hand and arm. That is a mannequin arm that he got and put the sleeve of an old fire suit and gloves on, and it's anchored to the car and made to look like he was holding on to the funny car as well. As a matter of fact, this kit has the arm in it to mount on the car if you want to. And I'm going to try to do that if I can get it to stay on the body with it, you know, being able to raise it up and down. We'll see how that goes. But anyway, just wanted to give you a little backstory there. I won't, you know, go too deep into it, but so that's what we're going to be doing. I got a couple of things done on it already. Not much, just a couple. I got the engine pretty much all together. Look at the chassis first. Chassis is just semi-gloss black, nothing out of the ordinary. Now, this is like a 7-piece chassis, and I was expecting a nightmare getting it together. But it actually went together very well. I mean, I didn't have any issues. You want to stay away from CA glue when you're putting these chassis with several, you know, pieces on it. You want to be able to get them together and get them to be adjusted, because if you don't get this right, then the car is going to, you know, be cattywampered when you put the axles together and put the wheels on it, and it's not going to set level. Now this is, even though it's kind of canted in the front, it's just the most of the weight's on the back. It is side to side level, and it's went together very well. Now what I like to do, and I may cover this in a how-to deal, is I use sprue glue quite a bit. And if you don't know what sprue glue is nothing more than just plastic melted in styrene cement. And I like to use Tamiya, the extra thin, and I usually keep a bottle of this, and I've got a bottle over there, and I won't get into it in this video, but I like to use it around where the frame pieces of the chassis pieces go together, the frames or whatever. A lot of times they leave little small gaps, even when if you heavily, you know, you put your styrene glue on there at the joints and squeeze them together and then sand them out. But what I like to do, I like to go back and put just a tad bit of sprue glue on those joints, and then you actually can't see where the joints came together. It looks like it's all one welded piece together. So as I said, I may do that, a little how-to on that down the road a piece. And I did that pretty heavily on the body, and I'll get into that on a later video when I show you how the body came out. Engine, nothing fancy, just pretty much stock right now. Now I did not use the belt pulley assembly, of course. This is pulleys from, I believe, actually I'm not sure where I got these. I had these in my stash. They are cast metal pulleys, and I'm going to use, I've got to find a belt. I may go just with electric tape if all else fails. I thought I had a ribbed belt from Speed City Resin, but I don't think I have one in stock here. I may see if they've got one in stock and order one for the belt, because these pulleys are, as you can see, they do have the teeth on the pulleys, and I'm not crazy about using a smooth belt on pulleys with teeth. I like to have a ribbed belt to go with the pulley, but if they don't have any, or now I did have one from another manufacturer, and I can't remember who it was, but it came to me all twisted, and it was rubber, and it got in shipping some kind of way, it got twisted around. I never could get it straight. It didn't look right. So painted the engine block Chevy engine red to kind of coincide with what he ran in the car. And then the rest of it's just numerous metalizers. These are all tester metalizers, just to give it that kind of put black wash and kind of grind it up a little bit. Not too bad, but I did want it to look like when these funny cars go down the track, inside that body, when the drivers get out, if they've got white fire seats, if you notice, they're just covered with black soot. So I kind of wanted to give that, kind of depict that on the motor, on the engine as well. So, and I'm not sure how far along in detail I'm going to go on this. It has a great detailed funny fuel pump from that I will be able to, if I want to, run some fuel plumbing from. Now, where you kind of get it, you have to be careful about funny cars plumbing them up, especially when you get up around the injectors or the bug catcher or whatever, because when the body comes down on the car, chassis and the engine, where the cutout on the body is for the engine to come through or the injectors to set up, a lot of time that is a very tight fit right in there, and sometimes the body will want to catch, you know, whatever you're using for fuel plumbing. So I never display my bodies up. I keep them in cases usually, and then there's just not room to, you know, to leave the bodies up, so I display them down. So what I may do is just run some plumbing from the fuel tank up to the pump, and then maybe a line from the pump up to a fuel regulator, and then the return line back from the regulator. I doubt if I will get into the injector plumbing, because then you're going to be getting close to it. I'll see how the body feels. I haven't test fitted the body or anything, so I don't know how much clearance I'm going to have. The windshield also has the cutout for the engine to sit, the top of the engine to sit in there. And so, you know, you got a lot of things going on right there in the close proximity to one another. So I don't want to, go to modifying the cutting on the body or whatever, just to allow for plumbing, fuel plumbing. You won't see it, you know, pretty much, unless you raise the body up. And, you know, when my stuff gets in their cases and go up on the shelf, they're not going to make a grand appearance anywhere. So, and I don't do shows anymore, so I don't have to worry about that. But I do kind of want to do something. You know, a car that's a tribute to a guy like Willie deserves at least a little something as far as the extra detail. So we'll probably do a little fuel line plumbing from the tank up to the pump, maybe from the pump, as I said, up to the regulator. I guess that's it for now. We've starting to make progress.
I'm rambling on.
We'll call it quits for now. Until I see you again, take care of one another. May God bless you and your family. Don't take any crap from anyone. See you soon.